All right, so today we are going to read Hoot, Chapter 5. Roy zipped his homework in an hour. When he came out of his room, he heard his mother talking to his father on the phone. He was saying that Trace Middle had decided not to take disciplinary action against Dana Matheson because of his injuries. Apparently, the school didn't want to provoke Dana's parents in case they were considering a lawsuit. When Mrs. Eberhardt began telling Mr. Eberhardt about the wild tussle between Dana and his mother, Roy slipped out the back door. He wheeled his bicycle from the garage and rode off. 20 minutes later, he arrived at Beatrice Leap's bus stop, and from there, he easily retraced Friday's ill-fated foot chase. When Roy got to the golf course, he locked his bike to the pipes of a water fountain and set off jogging down the same fairway where he'd gotten clobbered. It was late in the afternoon, steamy, hot, and a few golfers were out. Nonetheless, Roy ran with his head down and one arm upraised for deflection in case another errant ball came flying in his direction. He slowed only when he reached the stand of Australian pines into which the running boy had vanished. The pine trees gave way to a tangled thicket of Brazilian peppers and dense ground scrub, which looked impenetrable. Roy scoured the fringes, looking for a trail of some human sign. He didn't have much time before it would get dark. Soon he gave up trying to locate an entry point and elbowed his way through the pepper trees, which scraped his arms and poked his cheeks. He shut his eyes and thrashed onward. Gradually the branches thinned and the ground began to slope. He lost his balance and went sliding down a ditch that ran like a tunnel through the thicket. There in the shadows, the air was cool and earthy. Roy spotted a series of charred rocks encircling a layer of ashes, a campfire. He knelt by the small pit and studied the packed dirt around it. He counted half a dozen identical impressions, all made by the same set of bare feet. Roy placed his own shoe beside the prints and wasn't surprised to see that they were about the same size. On a whim, he called out, "Hello? Are you there?" No answer. Slowly, Roy worked along the ditch, hunting for more clues. Concealed beneath a mat of vines, he found three plastic garbage bags, each tied at the neck. Inside the first bag was common everyday trash, soda bottles, soup cans, potato chip wrappers, apple cores. The second held a bag of boys' clothing, neatly folded t-shirts, blue jeans, and underpants. But no socks and shoes, Roy observed. Unlike the other bag, the third one wasn't full. Roy loosened the knot and peeked, but he couldn't see what was inside. Whatever it was, it felt bulky. Without thinking, he turned the bag over and dumped the contents on the ground. A thick pile of brown ropes fell out. Then the ropes began to move. "Uh-oh," Roy said. Snakes, and not just any snakes. They had broad, triangular heads, like the prairie rattlers back in Montana, but their bodies were muck-colored and ominously plump. Roy recognized the snake as cottonmouth moccasins, highly poisonous. They carried no rattles to warn in advance of a strike, but Roy saw that the tips of their stubby tails had been dipped in blue and silver sparkles, the kind used in art projects. It was the most particular touch. Roy struggled to remain motionless while the fat reptiles untangled themselves at his feet. Tongue slipping, some of the moccasins extended to their full length while the others coiled sluggishly. Roy counted 9 in all. This wasn't good, he thought. He almost leaped out of his sneakers when a voice came out from behind him. "Don't move," the voice commanded. "I wasn't planning to," Roy said. "Honest." When he lived in Montana, Roy once hiked up to the Pine Creek Trail into the Atabarca Range, which overlooked Paradise Valley and Yellowstone River. It was on a school field trip with 4 teachers and about 30 kids. Roy had purposely dropped to the rear of the line when the others weren't looking. He peeled away from the group. Abandoning the well-worn path, he angled back and forth up the side of the wooded ridge. His plan was to cross over the top and quietly sneak down ahead of the school hikers. He thought it would be funny if they trudged onto the campsite and found him napping by the creek. Hurriedly, Roy made through the forest of towering lodgepole pines. The slope was littered with brittle dead logs and broken branches, and the debris of many cold, windy winters. Roy stepped gingerly to avoid making noise, for he didn't want the hikers down below to hear him climbing. As it turned out, Roy was too quiet. He walked into a clearing and found himself facing a large grizzly bear with 2 cubs. It was impossible to say who was the more startled. Roy had always wanted to see a grizzly in the wild, but his buddies at school had told him to dream on. Maybe in Yellowstone Park, they said, but not up here. Most grown-ups spent their whole lives out west without ever laying eyes on one. Yet, there was Roy, 100 feet across the glade with 3 serious bears, snorting, huffing, rising their hind legs to scope him out. Roy remembered that his mother had packed a canister of pepper spray in his backpack, but he also remembered what he read about bear encounters. The animals had poor eyesight, and the best thing to do is for a human to remain perfectly still and silent. So that's what Roy did. The bear squinted and growled and sniffed his scent in the wind, but then made sharp coughing. Then she made sharp coughing noise, and her cubs obediently dashed off into the woods. Roy swallowed hard, but he didn't move. The mother bear rose to her full height, bared her yellow teeth, and faked a lunge towards him. Inside, Roy was quaking with terror, but on the outside, he remained calm and motionless. The bear studied him closely. Her changing expression suggested to Roy that she'd figured out that he was too meek and puny to pose a threat. After a few tense moments, she dropped to all fours and, with a final defiant snort, lumbered off to collect her cubs. Still, Roy didn't move a muscle. He didn't know how long those bears had gone or whether they'd come back to stalk him. For 2 hours and 22 minutes, Roy remained as stationary as a plaster statue on that mountainside until one of his teachers found him and led him safely back to the group. So Roy was extremely good at not moving, especially when he was scared. And he was plenty scared now, with 9 venomous snakes crawling around his feet. "Take a deep breath," advised the voice behind him. "I'm trying," Roy said. "Okay, now step backwards real slow on the count of 3. "Oh, I don't think so," said Roy. 1. "Now wait a second." 2. "Please," Roy begged. 3. "I can't." 3, the voice said again. Roy's legs felt like lumber as he teetered backward. A hand seized his shirt and yanked him into the thicket of pepper trees. As Roy's butt landed in the dirt, a hood came down over his face and his arms were jerked behind his back. Before he could react, a rope was looped twice around his wrist and secured to the trunk of the tree. Roy could feel the smooth, sticky bark when he wiggled his fingers. "What's going on?" he demanded. "You tell me," the voice had moved in front of him. "Who are you and why are you here?" "My name is Roy Eberhardt. I saw you run by the school the other day." "I don't know what you're talking about." "On 2 different days, actually," Roy said. "I saw you running and I got curious. You look kind of, I don't know, wired." "Wasn't me." "Yeah, it was." The snake wrangler was using a fake husky tone, the voice of a boy trying to sound like a grown-up. Roy said, "Honest, I didn't come out here to hassle you. Take off this hood so we can see each other, okay?" He could hear the boys breathing. Then, "You're going to have to get out of here, like, right now." "What about the snakes? They're mine." "Yeah, but they won't go far. I'll catch them again later." "That's not what I meant." The boy laughed. "Don't worry. I'll take you out the back way. Just do as I say and you won't get hurt." "What a guy," muttered Roy. The boy untied him from the Brazilian pepper and boosted him to his feet. "I got to admit, you did pretty good. Most kids would have peed their pants." "Are those cottonmouths?" Roy asked. "Yep." The boy sounded pleased that Roy knew what kind of snakes they were. "Where I used to live, we had lots of rattlers," Roy volunteered. He thought that if he could start a friendly conversation, the kid might change his mind and take the hood off Roy's face. "I'd never heard of a cottonmouth with sparkles on his tail." "They're going to a party. Now start walking." The boy grabbed Roy from behind and guided him forward. He had a strong grip. "I'll tell you when to duck for branches," he said. The hood was either black or dark blue, and Roy couldn't see a speck of light through the heavy fabric. Blindly, he stumbled and swayed through the thicket, but the barefoot boy kept him from falling. Roy knew they were out of the trees when the air got warmer and the ground beneath his feet got flat. He could smell the fertilized sod of the golf course. Soon they stopped marching, and the boy began to loosen the knot on Roy's wrists. "Don't turn around," he said. "What's your name?" Roy asked. "I don't have a name no more." "Sure you do. Everybody's got a name." Kid grunted. "I've been called Mullet Fingers, and I've been called worse." "You don't really live out here, do you?" "None of your business if I do." "All by yourself? What about your family?" Roy asked. The boy rapped him lightly on the back of the head. "You ask too many nosy questions." "Sorry." Roy noticed his hands were free, but he continued to hold them behind his back. "Don't turn around till you count to 50, the kid instructed him. "Otherwise, you're going to wake up one morning with one of those big cottonmouths in your bed. Got it?" Roy nodded. "Good, now start counting." 1, 2, 3, 4, Roy said aloud. When he reached 50, he whipped the hood off his head and wheeled around. He was alone in the middle of the range, surrounded by acres of golf balls. The barefoot boy was gone again. Roy ran all the way back to his bicycle and rode home as fast as he could. He wasn't frightened and he wasn't discouraged. He was now more excited than ever. All right, let me pull up the questions. Chapter 5, Reading Comprehension Questions. 1. What animal did Roy encounter when he went to go find the running boy? This is what fell out of the bag. 2. Does the barefoot boy have a name? This is a yes or no question. All right. Hope that you enjoyed that chapter. And I look forward to reading to you again tomorrow.